online or whether you're here in St. Mary's, it's lovely that we can be together but still apart as we come though to worship God. As we gather, let's pray. Loving God, thank you for your heart towards us. Thank you that you are the God who gave your Son for us. You come near and you transform us. We ask in and through our service today, would you do that for each of us? In Jesus' name, amen. Do have a look at the notices that we have, whether you've got those online or have picked up a copy in church. And particular one just to point out to you is that Pentecost next Sunday, if the weather's fine, which we're hoping it will be, we will be having the service in the front of church. Do bring a deck chair or a chair to sit on. And if you want to stay on and have some refreshments, bring your own. And that's informally up to you. We're trying to work out what we can and can't do with the restrictions. Screens. Please respond with the words in bold. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And now those of you who are at home can sing aloud, and please sing loud for those of us who can't sing in church. And Gary is going to lead us now. Thank you, Gary.
Song, so I was given the wrong ones. I'll do this one first. Yeah. We're going to sing A Good, Good Father.
And I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Because you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Because you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, and this love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Thank you. I think we're going to carry on now with "This Is My Desire." Is that correct?
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart. I worship you. All I have within me, I give you. In you, Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart. I worship you. All I have within me, I give you. I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, have your way in me.
Yes, Lord, have your way in each one of us. In those places where we struggle, have your way. In those places where we enjoy spending time with you, have your way. And have your way in us as we come to say sorry to you. Just take a moment, just letting God minister to us. Lord Jesus, you suffered a cruel death on the cross for our redemption, yet we have forgotten your pain and stayed in the realm of the evil you defeated. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you were raised from death to bring us new life, yet we have preferred the comfort of the familiar and the empty promises of a sinful world. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you have ascended to your Father and our Father, your God and our God. Plead there at the right hand of God for our forgiveness and entry into the fullness of his presence. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the God of love bring you back to himself, forgive you your sins, and assure you of his eternal love. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you like to stand, those who are in church, those who are at home, just be aware of what you're saying. Well, I hope we all are. We're going to respond, and his mercy endures forever. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious. He has loved us from all eternity and remembered us when we are in trouble, for his mercy endures forever. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, for his mercy endures forever. He became incarnate of the Holy Spirit in the Virgin Mary and was made man. For his mercy endures forever. By his cross and passion, he has redeemed the world. For his mercy endures forever. And has washed us from our sins in his own blood. For his mercy endures forever. On the third day, he rose again. For his mercy endures forever. And has given us the victory. For his mercy endures forever. He ascended into heaven. For his mercy endures forever. And opened wide for us the everlasting doors. For his mercy endures forever. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. For his mercy endures forever. And ever lives to make intercession for us. For his mercy endures forever. Please, will you sit down? And we're not having the reading quite yet. We're going to just, if we keep that screen. I'm aware we've got two youngsters in church, and there are probably some at home. So, Fred and Elisa, I'd like you just to help me, please. Here,
if you can say where you are, well, unless you run this line.
Can you tell me what we've got here, Fred and Elisa? A heart, right, thank you very much. And what does a heart tell you? What does a heart represent? Any ideas? Adults, grown-ups, bigger children? Love. Yeah, heart represents love. It's all about those things that your mum and dad look after you and show you, and that brothers and sisters are meant to do and to help and support one another. Fantastic. Now, can you also tell me what red, which service, whether it's fire, police, or ambulance, you might want if you saw something very bright and red? What might flames be like? Fred and Elisa, any ideas? Light, possibly, yep. Danger. Flames of fire. Fire, thank you. And this, as we're coming to Pentecost, it's all about the flames of God coming and his power coming. But it's also God's love for us, that it is bright and shining on the inside for us. And I know that children, sometimes it can be quite hard listening to grown-ups talking. So I thought that you two might like just to think about all the good things that you like about love and those children at home. And just think that God's love for you is just like that. And we used to sit on this in the last place I was, as a reminder to sit on God's love. So I'll pass this over to you. And Joan is going to bring us our reading. Thank you, Joan.
The reading is in two parts this morning, the first one being from John chapter 17, verses 20 to 26, followed by Acts 1, 16 to 17, and then 20 to the end. Jesus prayed, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am, and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them, and will continue to make you known, in order that the love you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, "Brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry. For," said Peter, "it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his place be deserted, let there be no one to dwell in it,' and 'May another take his place of leadership.' Therefore, it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living among us. Beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us, for one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." So they nominated two men, Joseph, called Barsabbas, also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over this apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs." Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias, so he was added to the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, and good morning, everyone. It's so wonderful, isn't it, to be back in church like this. When Sarah asked whether I wanted to preach from home over Zoom, and or to come back into this wonderful building. I jumped to the chance to be here. So it's wonderful for us who are here, but I know it's great for those of you still at home. So let's all really help try to be one big family, even though we're spread out. So welcome this morning. Can anyone see a bluey coloured folder somewhere I've left? No, it's disappeared. Never mind. Don't panic, Mr. Mannering. That's the thing, isn't it? Good. What I want to do this morning is actually tell you perhaps something slightly shocking in that last reading that Joan read to us, which is in that period between the Ascension, which we celebrate last Thursday, and the Day of Pentecost, which is next Sunday, these 10 days are kind of a transition period. And that account in the book of Acts is what's read every time, every year, on this particular Sunday. But I want to tell you something really shocking. The apostles got it wrong, okay? Now that's a bit harsh, isn't it, for me to stand here and to say something about the 12, and particularly about Peter, standing up on that Sunday, sorry, whatever day it was of the week, and saying, well, this is what we need to do now. We've lost one of our members, we need to replace him. And the reason I'm saying that they got it wrong is that they are actually working in an old covenant way of thinking. They have chosen to go the way that they were used to, in the way that they learned from their mother's knee, if you like, and in the synagogues. But unfortunately, it's also the way that church normally works and the way a lot of Christians work. And there's a kind of process you can see there in what they actually did. Now, the first thing they decided, well, we've got a problem. We're missing someone, okay? So how are we going to solve this? So they scratched their heads, and Peter then said, well, I think we need to appoint someone to replace Judas. Judas was appointed by Jesus as one of the 12, and Peter's saying we need to find someone to replace him. So they decide to do this according to the procedure that they knew from what happened, I presume, in the synagogue. They decided to cast lots amongst the people who had actually been with them most of the time and who actually were witnesses to the resurrection. Now, we know there were a lot of witnesses. St. Paul tells us that there were 500 people at least who saw Jesus risen from the dead. So they had plenty of choice there. But they chose these two men, and then they said, let's cast lots. Now, that is a procedure that comes out of the Old Testament. And you remember in the beginning of Luke's Gospel, where we read about John the Baptist's father, Zechariah, thank you ever so much. You need a bit of prompting now and again. Zechariah, do you remember Zechariah? It says that he was actually burning incense in the temple when the angel came to see him, and that he had been chosen by lot to do that job. Now, I'm sure he was very pleased to be able to do it, but it was just, if you like, a random choice that was made for him. So we find here, this is the way that Peter and the other apostles decide to do it. We then find that they actually do actually go to the scriptures and find some verses that kind of justify what they're doing. We find it a bit hard to work out why they, well, one of them actually justifies it. But anyway, that's what Peter and the apostles did. They went to the Bible and said, look, we can find some verses in the Bible that actually justifies what we're doing. And they also prayed. Peter prays in that passage. He asks God to bless what they're doing. And then they do exactly what they said, and they cast lots, and the lot passes to Matthias. Now, the interesting thing, of course, is we never hear about Matthias again. No one knows anything about him. What I want to say to you is that they got it wrong. And they got it wrong, we know, from two reasons. One is it's fairly clear from the rest of the book of the Acts of the Apostles that Paul was actually Jesus' choice for the 12th apostle to replace the one who had was doomed for destruction. And we know another reason that they got it wrong is that the procedure that they've used is wrong. It's an old covenant procedure. And by now, they should have been working in the new covenant. Now, we see the contrast just a few days later on the day of Pentecost. And there, and this is what gets Peter back in the right books, is that Peter did actually respond in the correct way. Can you see that on the day of Pentecost, something completely different happens? First of all, God does something. God actually moves in an unmistakable way with the tongues of fire and the rushing wind and the people speaking in different languages. God actually did something. And what Peter did then, he then went to the scriptures on the basis of what God was doing. He didn't have to thumb through the whole of the book to find something that he wanted to find. He found almost immediately, I'm sure from his memory, this passage in the book of Joel, where it explained what God was doing. You know, it says there, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. And Peter said, this is that. I love that phrase. It's in the authorized version of the Bible. This is that was described by the prophet Joel all those centuries before. So he's going from what God is doing then to the scriptures, because he knows where to go to now. It's not a matter of him choosing a verse that he thinks is going to be appropriate. He knows here's something that was written that fits very exactly with what God is doing. And then he says, I now know from putting these two things together, the Spirit and the Word, what God wants us to do. And therefore, when the people in Jerusalem said to him, "What, brothers, what shall we do?" He said, repent and be baptized, and then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And of course, we know exactly what happened. 3,000 people accepted his word and were baptized and added to the church. So the church went from 120 to 3,000 in one go. And if that isn't a miracle, I don't know what is. Now, can you see the difference between these two approaches? The pre-Pentecostal approach that Peter and the apostles took of doing things that they think they ought to do and then using the Bible and prayer to justify that. And the other way is waiting. Because that's what Jesus said to them, isn't he? In the end of the Gospel of Luke, we read that Jesus said to them, wait in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. Very clear, isn't it? He didn't say you've got to go and sort things out before that happens. He just said, wait for something to happen. Didn't tell him exactly what it was going to be, because God always surprises. But when it happened, it was unmistakable. Now this, I believe, is what the new covenant church needs to be about. We need to be a people who are not always thinking of what we ought to do next, but we ought to be a people who are waiting in anticipation for God to do something, or for God to say something, or for God to reveal something to us that then sets us off on the way we can go. And we have this assurance, I think, there from the Bible, that we can use the Bible to check out. The book of 1 Corinthians talks about the gift of discernment, which is something we need to exercise. We need to put what God is doing together with what we know there is already there. And when we put them together, the same thing happens. And it's been my experience. We do that, we put the two together. It then becomes clear what we need to do. Can you see the contrast here? Now I ask, guys at the back, could you show up the first one? Okay. So this is part of the gospel, the end of the gospel reading. This is part of Jesus' great high priestly prayer, we call it. And this is the end of it. Now, do you remember on London Sunday night at the London Palladium, or as my mother-in-law used to call it, the Ladju Palladju, but she was Polish, so she was allowed to do that, wasn't she? Anyway, at the London Palladium, the most important act on the bill was always the one that came last, wasn't it? So I believe what happens at the end of this great high priestly prayer is the key thing there. And the last thing that Jesus prays is those words, and those extraordinary words, and that I myself may be in them. Jesus actually prayed to the Father for his disciples who were there, but also for all of us, and makes that very clear too, that he would come and live within us, that we would have that intimate connection with him that can only be expressed by this idea of him living in us. And that idea is more than just an idea. It's a reality. And that's part of what it means to be able to live as new covenant Christians, to know the presence of the Lord Jesus in us, guiding us and helping us to know the way to go. And we have the Bible, the scriptures, to go to as a benchmark, as a way of checking out what we believe God is calling us to do. And we can bring the two together, as Peter did on the day of Pentecost. Could you show us, thank you very much. This is a passage from the Old Testament, and it's the prophet Jeremiah. This passage is picked up also in the book of Hebrews in the New Testament, where we realize that Jeremiah is talking about what we call the New Covenant, what the Bible calls the New Covenant. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. That's talking about this intimate connection, that he will be able to speak to us and guide us dynamically. I will be their God and they will be my people. Again, this close, intimate connection. And the last passage, please. No longer will they teach their neighbor and say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. Okay, didn't need special people. It just needed the body of the church to come together on the day of Pentecost, and for the Holy Spirit to be poured out on all of them, not just the apostles, not just the 11 or the 12 at that point, on everyone. And for all of them to be able to go out into the streets and to proclaim the wonders of God, as it says, in the different languages that God gave them. That's God's way of working. And they did need to wait in the city until they were clothed with power from on high. And they will all know me, the Lord says, from the least of them to the greatest. Now, I did think of actually giving you some, telling you about some stories from my experience or from Boz's experience that kind of explains this a bit more. But in the end, I tell you something that I really believe God said to me. There are no formulas. So the danger in giving examples is that people think that it's something to copy. And the whole point of what we're talking about here is being led by the Lord Jesus himself, by allowing him to be the leader and us the followers, to actually responding to his repeated call to when he said, follow me. So I really felt, rather than give you some examples, I'll just give you some principles that I think have come out of the experience that Bozzy and I have had over the last few years, last 10, 15 years. The first is, I do believe it's important to get our theology straight. Okay. That we need to be willing to take on board some of the things I've talked about, some of the things that I've written in the book that I've written called Follow Me. There are some copies at the back. It's important that we do actually take this on board. It's very easy, isn't it, just to carry on with the kind of faith and understanding of the Christian faith that we've grown up with, or that's part of what our denomination or our fellowship has taken on. It is important for us to actually say, look, this is possible. It is possible to live by revelation, by allowing Jesus really to be the head of the church and not just nominally. He's not like the Queen. You know, the Queen is nominally head of our country, head of our government. But of course, she has no real power. Jesus isn't that kind of monarch at all, is he? Jesus is king, and we need to allow him to be king and allow him to be head of his body, which is us. So we need to get hold of this ideas, this understanding. Theology is the only word I can think of to use it. It's a way of expressing what we believe. And secondly, then, I think we do need to be able to be willing to listen and to sometimes actually give up what we're doing, to say, just because it's always the way we've always done it, or just because we think it's a new idea that's come from somewhere. We need to be able to really put these things down sometimes. That's what the apostles needed to do in those 10 days, just to put down everything that they'd learned from the past and allow Jesus to allow to happen what Jesus had promised them. So I hope that does make some kind of sense. And I hope in this particular sort of transition time between the Ascension and Pentecost, we can realize that there is so much potential for us as a church, for us as a church in this country, for us as a church worldwide, and for us as individuals, if we really just can grasp what God is calling us to do and to be. Amen.
Let's just pray. Father, help us to be aware of those things that you are saying. Help us to be still, to hear your call and your whispers to us, and your surprises, as we wait for your leading and your guiding. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Prayers this morning are based on the Lord's Prayer. If you could respond, as I say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Risen, ascended Lord, as we rejoice at your triumph, fill your church on earth with power and compassion, that all may be estranged by sin, may find forgiveness and know your peace. Help us to live the prayers we ask. Help us to be agents of your healing, your love, mercy, peace, and hope. We offer our lives and prayers to you in the name of our ascended Lord. Keep us ready and willing to serve you all of our days. Father, we want to be still and listen to your still small voice as we come before you in prayer. May our souls wait in silence. May our souls thirst for you. May we come before you with empty hands, waiting attentively to hear your words. May we sit at your feet, be still and know you are God. May the Holy Spirit fill us with your penetrating words. May we hear words of conviction, words of love, or in the silence, know your presence. Our Father in heaven, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. Thank you, Lord, that you have adopted us as your children and that you have drawn us to yourself with your loving kindness. Thank you that you have protected and shielded us. Thank you for your unconditional love for us all. You are the Father of all compassion and comfort. We give thanks that your love is freely given, that it is so high and so deep. Father, we pray for those who do not yet know you, across our communities, our nation, in our families and friends, and across the world. We pray that their eyes may be opened, that they will know there is a God of heaven who longs to be their Father. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, may they know that you are a good, good Father who gives love and good gifts to those who turn to him. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Hallowed be your name. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your mind and with all your strength. May your name be exalted over all the earth. May you always be glorified, for who is there like you? Your thoughts are so much higher and greater than ours. We pray for the people of this nation. We come before you in sorrow for the lack of love for our neighbours. We pray that people will turn to you, that you will reign into people's hearts, that they will honour you and love their neighbours in your overwhelming love. We pray for revival and healing across this land, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow and tongues confess that you are Lord of all. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Your kingdom come, your will be done. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of the Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truths and teach me. Do not conform to the patterns of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. We give thanks that Jesus came to bring the kingdom of heaven to earth. That, Lord, you release that kingdom and are calling all to repent in your love for us, calling us to believe the kingdom of God is near. Thank you, through the sacrifice of Jesus, the way is open to the things of heaven. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son that we might have everlasting life. We pray for your justice across this world and this land. We pray that our government and those that reach out into the world will look justly upon the people. That those who lead us will look outside of themselves and their eyes will be open to the needs of the people they serve. That they will be transformed with softened hearts, hearts of love, hearts to serve, hearts to understand, hearts filled with compassion. May those with Christ in their hearts be called to serve this world and this country, and be Christ's light, heart, and wisdom amongst the people, that we may see things that are not of you unraveled, so that you will may be done and your kingdom may come. Give us our daily bread, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Jesus Christ. We pray that the people of the world, the nation, and the communities will not go hungry. We lift especially today those in need in India and in Asia, where the COVID pandemic is ravaging through the cities and rural communities. To all countries where poverty, disease, and suffering is rife, you are our refuge and our fortress, God in whom we trust. We lift our brothers and sisters. We pray for protection, provision, and courage for them in their fear, and as they mourn the loss of those they love. We pray for those who struggle to breathe, that you will pour through the power of your Holy Spirit air into their lungs. We lift the health workers who live their lives each day to care for those who are sick. We pray they receive the oxygen and other medical supplies that they need to give vital treatments. We pray for all mission partners and agencies that are working with the people. May your armor of protection surround them in their need. We think of those who are sick in our own church family and the community, the nation and the world. Those who we do not know, you know them all by name, and you love them beyond measure. Remind us, Lord, that you are always with us. You draw us close into your presence in our time of need. We ask for your words of truth, overwhelming love and compassion, to bring healing to those in physical, emotional, or mental pain or anguish. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, strengthen them, we pray, in their hearts and innermost being. We pray for them to be healed and to come to a place of wholeness in you. May their needs be met. May you call us and fill us to share your love, prayer, and walk alongside those in need each and every day. The Lord is bigger than our need. He is our shepherd, and we shall not want. Jesus said, "Do not be anxious, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your prayers be known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ." May your will be done. May your kingdom come. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Father, your Son and the Holy Spirit are one. We experience that oneness in the body of Christ. Lord, we pray, please guard us from disunity, from not living in the way you have created us to be. You send your Son that we might live. We pray that the world will believe. We pray for oneness in the church. We pray for the salvation of the world and its people. The world is such a diverse culture, where there is conflict and strife, where people are so prone to living in conflict, trying to cancel out one another and turning against one another. We think especially of the conflict in Israel and Palestine and those in conflict in other war-torn lands. Those in our own land who turn violence against others, those who do not respect your creation and the gift of life. Lord, forgive those in your overwhelming love and grace who truly repent. May the body of Christ bring those who are hurting and in pain to you, to release them into your loving arms. We pray that the church and the world will receive a deeper revelation of the power of forgiveness for those who are in conflict, those who are wounded, that they may know your everlasting peace and have freedom in you. May your kingdom come. May your will be done. For yours is the kingdom. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, together thrones or powers or rulers or authority. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. We pray that the kingdom of God will break out across the world in every street, village, town, and city. We pray the light of the kingdom of God will shine brightly and all will be drawn to the light. May we as a church and all people's eyes and spirit be open to insight and revelation of who you are. May people be blessed with your love, peace, joy, and hope, even in these difficult days. May your light shine. May your kingdom come. May your will be done. And as we close our prayers, Lord, you search us and you know us. You know our sitting down and our rising up. You discern our thoughts from afar. You mark our journeys and our resting places. Where can we go from your spirit? Where can we flee from your presence? If we take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even then, your hand shall lead us, and your right hand hold us fast. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you, Jane. We come to the peace. For those of you who are at home, I forgot to say that we will be having an agape at the same time as we're having communion, so in the short time you might want to go and get some bread and wine. The slides will be up for you at the end of the communion prayer. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love you gave us Jesus your Son to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise. We join with them in heaven's song. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light. With signs of faith and words of hope, he touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. This is his story. This is our song, Hosanna in the highest. The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story. This is our song, Hosanna in the highest. Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body given for you." This is my body given for you all. Jesus then gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup, gave it, and said, "This is my blood shed for you all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." This is our story. This is our song, Hosanna in the highest. Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. This is our story. This is our song, Hosanna in the highest. Send your spirit on us now that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with opened eyes on fire. May we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. And together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of all salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us, and we in him, and that we with the whole company of Christ may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. As those of us in church come forward, the words are there for those at home. Please do come. Father of all. Give you thanks and praise, that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And so we join those at home in singing our last song, and those in church, we echo it in our hearts. Thank you, Gary.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We gather together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on our grace. Sing that again. In the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We gather together to lift up your name, and to call on our Savior, to fall on our grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as the saints bow down, as the people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that how God saves, how God saves. There is hope in your name.
Right back to the first verse.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We gather together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on our grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as the saints bow down, as the people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that how God saves, how God saves. There is hope in your name. Morning turns to songs of praise. How God saves, how God saves, how God saves, how God saves. There is hope in your name, how God saves.
Yes, Lord, you save, and you have saved us. We thank you and we praise you. And now the Spirit of truth, lead you into all truth. Give you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and strengthen you to proclaim the word and works of God. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and all you love, this day and always. Amen. Bless you. Thank you for coming. For those at home on Zoom, you're going to have breakout groups now and have a chance to get to know one another, which is lovely. For those of us in church, we are encouraged to disperse quickly, but I leave that with you, and we'll be leaving from this door. But bless you and have a lovely week. We have a good God who walks with us and loves us. Amen. And thank you very much to the tech guys. Thank you. Brilliant. Thank you.